Now we can start looking at the ripple carry adder. So a ripple carry adder is a logic circuit in which the carry out of each full adder is the carry input of the succeeding next most significant full adder. So it is called full adder because each carry bit gets rippled into the next stage. Because if you see this diagram here, this is the full adder, this is the full adder, one bit full adder, this is the full adder, this is the full adder. And as you can see here, the carry output of each full adder is going to the full adder of the next significant full adder. So this output of full adder is the input of this full adder, and this output of full adder is the input of this full adder, and so on. And since this carries are rippled into the next stage of the full adder, that's why they are called as ripple carry adder. So it is also called the parallel binary adder. And from this ripple carry adder, we can perform the addition of n bit binary digits in such a manner. So if we have seen that in a half adder, we can add only binary numbers of single bit of single bit, and similarly same is true for full adder. But if we have to add binary numbers of 4 bit, 5 bit and 6 bit and so on, then for that we will require a ripple carry adder. So for designing a full adder, we will first need to take a look at module instantiation in Verilog. So what is a module instantiation? We have to look at it first. So a Verilog module can be instantiated into other module by positional mapping and name mapping. So there are two methods of Verilog module instantiation. Number one is positional mapping and the second one is name mapping. So in a positional mapping, module ports are simply connected by the order of module instantiated. So here order is everything. So you have to take care of the order in which you are defining the ports. And in the name mapping, signals of instantiation ports are explicitly associated with module ports, i.e. order is unimportant. So here, name mapping order is unimportant. You can define it in any order you want, but you have to follow this generalized syntax for name mapping: module name followed by the name of the instantiation, followed by the dot module port, and followed by the signal name. And we are going to take a look at here. So how we do name mapping and positional mapping, we are going to learn them as well in this tutorial. And most programmer uses name mapping as it is more easy to troubleshoot, and we are going to use name mapping as well because it is very easy to troubleshoot and very easy to define as well. Format of module instantiation in any case, so this is the generalized syntax for module instantiation, whether it is positional mapping and name mapping. So now we have two examples here. This one is defines positional mapping and this one defines name mapping. So here, if you see this this line here defines the module instantiation in positional mapping. So since this module here is the half adder, so this is the module name, half adder, followed by the instantiation name. We are going to call it as HA. You can define it whatever you want. You can define it as HB, SC, or whatever you want, followed by the AB, SC. Since this inputs AB, SC are the inputs of this module, so we declare them here. Since A must be the input, B must be the input. Order is everything in position mapping, so A must be the A must be connected to A, B must be connected to B, S must be connected to S, and so on. Similarly, A and B must be inputs, and S and C must be outputs. Order is everything. So this is how the positional mapping is done. Similarly, in name mapping, we have the same module half adder. We define the name of the module half adder followed by the instance name. We're going to call it as HA. Then we are going to tell the compiler, the program, that dot a, that means this A must be connected to this W of this module. So that means dot a of this module must be connected to W of this module. Similarly, dot s, the s output of this module must be connected to Y of this module. Similarly, dot B of this module must be connected to X output or input of this module. So therefore, we don't need to worry about the ordering of this module ports. We can declare it in any order we want. As you can see here, A, B, S is the order, but we are defining it as A, S, B, C. So therefore, we don't need to worry about the order, but we have to tell the program that this output of this module must be connected to this input of this module. So this is how the name mapping is done. Finally, we are going to write code for the 4-bit triple carry adder. This module here defines the 4-bit this module here defines the full adder, which we have discussed in the previous slides. So for designing a ripple carry adder, we have to instantiate as number of times as the bits required for the ripple carry adder. For example, if you are designing a 4-bit triple carry adder, then you have to instantiate 4 number of times this full adder to define a 4-bit triple carry adder. So first of all, we are going to call module followed by the name of the program, adder 4-bit followed by the outputs. S and C out are the outputs, and A, B, C and C in are the inputs. And we are going to call input 0 to 3 A and B, since A 0 to 3 defines the bits of A and B. So 0 to 3 is total 4. So 4 bits of A and 4 bits of B. So that's how it goes. Similarly, we have input C in, and we have 4 number of sum outputs. We are going to call it as 0 to 3. That means we have 4 bits of sum, and 0 to 2, that means we have 3 bits of carry and a single carry output. As you can see it here from this diagram, we have A0, B0, A1, B1, total 8 number of A and B, and total A0, A1, A2 and A3, total 4 number of A and 4 number of B. We have 4 number of outputs, sum outputs, a single carry output, and 4 number of carries here, C0, C1, C2 and C3. So we define the number of bits from this diagram. So now we are going to instantiate this adder. For the first full adder, the output of first full adder will be S0, the first bit of sum, and C0, the first bit of carry. These are the output of first full adder, followed by the inputs. A0 and B0 will be the inputs of this first full adder. A0, B0 defines the first bit of A and first bit of B, and C in is the first carry input of this first full adder. Similarly, we are going to instantiate the second full adder, followed by the module name full adder, followed by the instance name F1, followed by the output. This second full adder will have output S1 and C1. These are the second bits of S and C. These are the outputs of second full adder. And the second full adder will have input A1 and B1, second bits of A and B. And the second full adder will have the carry input from the previous full adder. So this is the output of the carry output of the first full adder. So it will be the input of the next full adder. So therefore, C0 is the input of second full adder. Similarly, this is the output of second full adder. So this must be the input of third full adder, which is C1. Similarly, this is the output of third full adder, which must be the input carry input of the final full adder, which is the fourth full adder. So this is how the carry inputs are rippled into the next most significant full adder. So this is how we define module instantiation. We are using a positional mapping here, but you can use name mapping as well. So this is the program for 4-bit triple carry adder. And now we have finished our second tutorial objectives. Now we can program the FPGA using the objectives that we have covered here. So let's ready for programming the FPGA. So this is the program of half adder that we are going to program onto the FPGA, and this program is the same as we have discussed in the slides, and we are going to use LCD for indication and LEDs as well. So for sum and carry output, we are going to display them onto the LCD to see if the program perfectly works. So this is the same program. Let's compile it first. After successfully compilation, we can download this program, upload this program onto the FPGA, and then we are going to take a look at each combination of input produces the correct output. So just wait for the successful compilation. Now after successful compilation, we can go to Tools, Programmer. Since the board is already connected, we can just press the Start button. Now the program has been successfully uploaded onto the board. Let's check the program. Since the program has been successfully uploaded, and this LCD here shows that the sum is 0, carry is 0, because A and B is 0. So 0 plus 0 is 0, sum is 0, carry is 0. So it is also shown on the LCD. And if we turn this input 1, so 0 plus 1 is 1, so the sum is 1 and carry is 0, indicated by the LCD and also shown by the LED here. So this is the sum LED, which indicates that the sum is 1. And if we turn the second input 1, so 1 plus 0 is 1, so the sum is 1, carry is 0, and since sum is 1, so the sum LED is glowing here. And if we turn both inputs 1, so 1 plus 1 is 0, so the sum is 0, but 1 plus 1 gives the carry, so the carry is 1. Since the carry is 1, so this is indicated by the carry LED here, which shows that the carry is 1. So now we have completed our second tutorial objectives. In the third tutorial, we are going to display a 2-digit decimal number on a 7-segment display. So I hope you like my video. Please don't forget to hit the subscribe button and press the bell icon so you never miss the next video of this FPGA course. Have a good day.